Okay, so I think, you know, we've got filmmakers here at all different stages in their careers, and I think one thing that everyone will agree is that the festival circuit can be challenging to navigate, it can be confusing. There are so many film festivals, they all have different rules and regulations, they all have different programming styles, they all have different premiere requirements. So how do you break it all down? So these wonderful people are going to help you with that this afternoon. So first we have Sharon Vidal, head programmer for shorts for the fantastic Tribeca Film Festival in New York. Then we have Landon Zackheim, another wearer of many hats, Sundance Film Festival, AFI Fest, director of programming for the Stanley Film Festival, which I believe happens in the hotel where The Shining is going, and head short film programmer for LAFF, and also a really talented filmmaker, so give him a hand. Dilcia Barrera, currently with Sundance Film Festival. Program. And at the very end, we have Amanda Salazar, who is formerly a festival programmer, but is now working with Fandor. She's the film acquisitions director at Fandor, which is an online streaming platform for short and long form content. And she'll tell you a lot more about that later. So I wanted to start with a question that I get asked by a lot of filmmakers. Filmmakers often send me their films and ask me to watch them and recommend festivals that they think would be a good fit for their film. So I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about each of your festivals and basically how you decide from your thousands of submissions which films are not only good films but the right fit for your festival brand, for want of a better word, and your audience. And to contextualize that, also let us know how many submissions you usually receive and how many films you eventually pick.
Sure. Okay, first of all, I think these could very well be the most comfortable panels ever.
They're wonderful.
So Tribeca, this year we got almost 3,200 submissions and we selected 60 shorts from those. I always say that my personal opinion is irrelevant, basically, in my job, because I'm not programming for myself. I'm programming for my audience, which in my case is a public-facing audience and a New York audience. So what does that mean? Bitter, sarcastic, jaded, challenging. So I need to select films that I feel are going to meet their needs, which are either a combination of films from regions of the world that they might not normally have an opportunity to see, storytelling that's strong, storytelling that's surprising. It's never, you know, there's no such thing as a Tribeca film. It's all about each film, thinking about each film and thinking about what my audience's response to that film is.
I have kind of the luxury of having a few different festivals with different missions, so something that we really like at one festival that may not fit there, we can maybe find another platform for. At AFI Fest this year, or rather last year for the 2014 festival, we've got about, I think 2,600 short submissions for about 44 slots, which was a little high. I think we're going to be going down to somewhere like 36 this year. And what we have a platform to do at AFI Fest is a lot more international work and a lot more experimental work. We have the luxury of kind of being a highly curated festival, so much like the feature program, which takes a lot of best of films from the year from Cannes, Toronto, Venice, we can do that with the shorts as well. And submissions are open there right now until July 24th. For the LA Film Festival, that just ended 2 days ago, and we got about, it was actually similar to Tribeca, we got about 3,200 short films, we had 60 slots over 6 programs that played once, and then we had about 17 in front of features, which was very high for us that year. We are looking there for primarily a lot of diversity. underrepresented voices, mostly American voices. So we're looking to have in our shorts program there more than 50% female filmmakers, more than 50% filmmakers of color. And again, a lot of local voices, US voices, and films that are accessible to an LA audience, which is a very different kind of bitter and sarcastic than New York. And the Stanley Film Festival, that's a very new festival. We've just opened up submissions. We're only a horror festival, so we're only looking for horror films, horror shorts, but varying gradations of that, because with any program, you want there to be kind of diversity of form and content. So we're not just looking for the same kind of horror short, although our audience, as we're learning, gravitates less to kind of artsy horror and more kind of slam-bang action horror. So we have two programs there, plus one student competition. Our student competition is a cash prize. And then for Sundance, I'll actually let Dilcia talk about that, where we work together. Dilcia was also the former senior programmer at AFI Fest, so we work together a lot.
So Sundance takes place in January. We receive about 8,000 submissions a year. We're a team of about 10 programmers, so the way we program is a little bit different. We don't have screeners. Everything is watched by a programmer. It takes about 6 months. We're looking for something different, innovative, something that catches our attention.
We have five narrative programs,
exactly.
Two doc showcases, one animation showcase, and we do play films in front of features, but it very much has to be the right film and fit very specific requirements that are paired with that feature. We play less in front of features.
And sometimes we do have a new frontier program, which is a more experimental art program. So it's a bigger team, it's a bigger process, which is why there's two of us and that you will meet here. But we also travel all over the world, so there's an opportunity for you to meet short film programmers from Sundance and different film festivals or different occasions. Sometimes we don't even meet each other until we deliberate the week of our deliberation.
Amanda, for Vendor, are you open for submissions?
Yes, we technically are, and I'll get to that. Maybe explain what Fandor is if you're not familiar with it. So Fandor is a subscription video on demand platform. We launched in 2011 at South by Southwest, so we are definitely new to the field, but we have over 7,000 titles currently, and we license everything. So and I'm sure what you guys are probably most interested in, the fact that we license short film. The platform is really based on and comes from a love of the filmmaker and making sure that they get visibility and also paid for their work. So Fandor also is built out in a way to give context to your work, so it's not just you log in, you pay a subscription fee, and then you watch films and you can pick different genres or where you know international, wherever you're looking for from a viewer perspective, but it's really about giving context to the film. So that's been built out in a way. Keyframe, if you're familiar with, is our online publication, which we have a lot of the top writers writing for us, critics doing interviews and what's going on in the film industry every day, which then connects back to some other initiatives that we have on Fandor, which is connecting different film festivals, working with filmmakers specifically. So going maybe to the submission question is that filmmakers can license directly to us. There does not have to be a distributor in place. And as Landon's nodding his head, Landon Short is actually licensed to Fandor from him. So, and I can get into that if you have any more questions about that, but the submission process really is about, it's not like a cold submission process, essentially, where you can just submit to Fandor, and all that information is online. We do have a reviewing process, and we are a curated site. So we will look at your film and get back to you on whether or not we will be licensing the film.
My next question was actually gonna be about reviewing process. We kind of covered it a little bit with Sundance, but could you talk a little bit about how it works with Fandor? How many people do you have looking at these films, and what's the process like?
We have a very small staff of looking at films. It's just three of us, and myself and then our chief content officer and another person that works in content. And really, again, looking at the fact that we do all links. I mean, we have, again, in the 7,000 title library, over 2,000 of those films are short films. And we're really just looking for quality movies. And it's the idea of storytelling can happen at any length. And that's from 30 seconds to 6.5 hours, which we definitely have. So, the process is, our audience, in a nice way, kind of maybe directing it back to Sharon and what you said of having a program for one specific audience, it's stepping back and the audience is much broader. We are, though, only currently available for streaming in the US and Canada. But international film do incredibly well for us, if you can imagine, because the access isn't as much for a lot of people to watch.
And do you show everything from more kind of straight narrative short film to experimental shorts?
Yes. Again, very much everything. We have an incredible experimental program, animation, different forms of storytelling. Most recently, we acquired the Criterion Collection in November that's been built out. And then we also, again, working with distributors and filmmakers is how, you know, the platform very much is.
And Sharon, what's your process like with Rebecca for Penny? Whittling
down? You know, because you were part of that process.
I know, but I have to pretend that I didn't.
Okay, so I have been with Tribeca. I just celebrated my 16th anniversary with Tribeca. So I was there actually 2 years before the festival started. So as we have matured, we've streamlined the system tremendously. And so for the past couple of years, I have a co-programmer named Ben Thompson. I have 2 associate choice programmers, and I have 6 screeners who are all professionals in the industry. Penny was one of my screeners, because it's very imperative to me that I need people whose eye I can trust. I can't double check anybody. I need to know that if someone like Penny said, you need to watch this, I'm watching it. And if they say pass, I'm passing on it. The numbers alone are overwhelming when you really think about it. You know, when I can't sleep at night, I think of short films jumping over the fence. From October on. And so, so that's our process. So basically, I watch a lot of the early admission submissions. My team comes on in a staggered fashion to prepare for the avalanche of submissions that come in during the final deadline. And then Ben and I watch all of the associate programmers and our screeners' top picks, and then we make the final selection.
So how many films would you say that you yourself watch?
This year I watched 920.
Oh wow, you actually logged it.
Yeah, we log it, yeah, we log it.
So it's pretty impressive numbers.
Yeah, and we have normally 8 to 9 programs, 5 narrative, 3 documentary, and 1's kind of like Jeopardy, that's the potpourri category. So it depends on the year. Some years that 9th program has been a horror program. Some years it's been an animation program. It's dictated by the submissions. Whatever I feel the strongest that I think would work for that 9th program. This year we did a interesting kind of experimental program called Gallery Opening that was very, had artistic pieces and dance pieces, and that was kind of dictated by the films that we loved the most. So that's the one in flux every year.
Great, so we have, you know, a lot of American filmmakers here who I imagine are relatively familiar with your respective festivals, maybe some international filmmakers who are less familiar with some of them. This is your opportunity to kind of pitch your festivals and say, why should the filmmakers apply to your specific festivals? What opportunities do you have for short filmmakers specifically at your festivals? I think sometimes short filmmakers worry that they'll get lost in the mix when there's features and documentaries vying for the audience and the industry's attention. So what do you do to ensure that short filmmakers do stay in the limelight? Start with one of the festival programmers. I want to extend that to you.
For many of them, it's about the experience at AFI Fest. It's a chance for folks who are not from LA to spend some time in Los Angeles, have an LA showcase for your film. That's the same with the LA Film Festival as well. Meet a lot of, since AFI Fest has a lot of kind of master filmmakers come out, you're at the same sort of events with them. We do have some industry brunches, and it becomes, you know, an opportunity to sort of be in the mix in that setting. We do a lot of year-end gala screenings as well, so a lot of folks on the Academy kind of track are around, so it's a good kind of opportunity, and it's a highly curated program. For LA Film Festival, it's much more about the audience, getting the audience to see your film, getting a lot of different types of audience to come in there in downtown Los Angeles. And kind of have discussions there and get your work out there to see sort of how it's doing, get feedback, talk to folks. The Stanley Film Festival, again, that's very much just horror. It's purely an experiential festival, so that exists to foster and breed community within the horror genre. So we have some master filmmakers, some up-and-coming filmmakers, some brand-new filmmakers, all kind of in the mix, playing all weekend. We do weird kind of interactive immersive games, late-night seances. We do have an industry panel, but it's mostly about filmmakers having fun together, so that's what we bring at that festival. And then Sundance is, you know, it's the big circus. It's an opportunity to kind of do all of those things. You have highly engaging, sold-out audiences. You have tons of industry and filmmakers running around. You have lots of opportunities and folks looking out to you because, and folks reaching out to you rather, because Sundance still is a very strong brand that kind of is able to help. We're able to help our filmmakers with Sundance a little bit more than in kind of some of these other festivals, not just because of the brand, but also because we have a large staff and a large kind of range of programs that our shorts can feed into. We have the Institute, which runs our labs and other programs, who look at our shorts programmers and meet our shorts programmers. We have great tracking of our shorts programmers, shorts filmmakers, to see what they're doing next. And we have a very high ratio of shorts filmmakers getting features into Sundance. Every year there are a couple of short films. It just works out that way, but there are a few shorts alums that have features in the festival every year that I've been there.
Yeah, because Sundance is known for discovering new American talent, that's where the industry, you know, from all over the world comes together. So it's a good opportunity because everyone's in one place. This town is super small where it takes place, little Park City, Utah. It's a great opportunity for you to show your film to a larger audience and like Landon said, because we are part of a bigger family, which is the Sundance Institute, we are able to provide resources, not only from our own grants and programs, but to continue creating more films, short films, international partnerships, and our labs.
Great,
and
what about you, Rebecca?
New York. You can make it there. You'll make it. Short programs are not marginalized at all. We screen each program 4 times, starting in huge houses of 450 people. So you get a lot of eyeballs. We also are very concerned, as the other festivals are, with providing our filmmakers with networking opportunities. So we have special industry events, closed events for industry and filmmakers. We have special directors brunch. And you know, basically, it's the experience of being there and the kind of rush of being around all these feature filmmakers and celebrities, and you know, the experience of, I know what launching at Tribeca can do for your career trajectory as with the other larger festivals. And so we all are in the same vein, discovering and nurturing. We hope you come back to us with your next projects. And you know, if you get into Tribeca, there's a very strong chance you might actually see Robert De Niro in person.
I guarantee you'll see Robert.
He'll be there.
Yeah. Well, I don't know about you guys, but they had an even late night seance. So. And Amanda, is there any kind of community building around your short film curation?
There is. It's, you know, Fandor, a lot of ways in listening to what you guys are saying and probably what you're thinking, or hopefully at some point, is that maybe Fandor is like the answer to that. Like, what do I do after I premiere at, you know, at Tribeca or, you know, Stanley, or I'm going to Sundance? And so Fandor in a lot of ways is trying to work with filmmakers. You know, the digital space has changed so many things, as I'm sure you guys are all aware. And it's really coming back to make sure that we can feature those filmmakers and really cultivate a community is what we're trying to do also online. So most recently we actually launched, so to kind of break it down as simple as possible, so if you directly license your film to us, we have this program, or the filmmaker initiative I was referencing is called FIX. We currently have 170 filmmakers that are a part of that initiative. And we add about 5 filmmakers a month, and that's based on, unlike the fact of where your submissions, you know, you'll get thousands that kind of build up over time. I mean, we don't have like a deadline, and we're, you know, have a film festival to put on. So it's just kind of a steady flow of submissions all the time. And so then we're weeding through and curating and finding who we want to bring in. And so we then thought, and really we're working with the filmmakers, because again, it's really about working with them on their, what they're currently working on or what they previously had. And this idea came about of, what if Fandor, not really in the same way of you know, original content, which a lot of other sites are doing. But our version of it was, how do we get those 170 filmmakers to think about their next short film specifically? Because there's not a lot of money, and you guys all know this, in the sense of making it back and also having the funding to do it. So with those 170 filmmakers, we opened up essentially a call for scripts. And we launched our first big shorts project. We are helping promote, and are producing 5 films. And then we actually partnered with a crowdfunding campaign, which was very important, because if you can imagine within the online community, it's about building an audience. And then we hope to have, in conjunction with a film festival that will premiere all 5 films. And then they'll also premiere online. So the idea too is about really allowing the filmmaker to make whatever they want. I mean, the projects range from a straightforward narrative to a very experimental documentary. So there was that as well. We're just kind of always continuing ideas of how we build that community with our filmmakers.
That sounds really exciting. We're talking a lot about communities. Sharon, I think you used the word nurturing. Programmers love to nurture talent. You know, that's why we all got into this. We love to find new talent. And if you get a programmer behind you, they will really go to bat for you. You know, they will help you get to the next step in your career. So obviously you can meet programmers at festivals like this, but what are some other ways that it's appropriate for filmmakers to reach out to programmers? And do you have any kind of no-nos or horror stories, ways that filmmakers might want to avoid sort of bombarding programmers, which we all know can sometimes happen?
Anybody? No, I get the horror stories. I have been stalked. I have been called at home late at night. I have had someone come into my office at NYU wearing a trench coat with his hand in his pocket. Said, "Are you Sharon Badal?" And I looked at him and I thought, "Is this how it's going to end for me?"
Again, I'm very
sorry. I thought it was you. Took out a DVD and said, "I want you to watch my film now."
Yeah.
Okay, so those are things not to do. But I think, outreach is fine. Being my pen pal is not. It's great to have a heads up. Every programmer appreciates the heads up. But that doesn't mean, you write me your life story. Like, just tell me that you submitted, give me your log line, that's it. Just put it on my radar. And then leave me alone. Because I keep a very detailed log of emails that I've received, what I call I've flagged them. So I have filmmakers that will follow up every week, every 2 weeks. And it's like, dude, leave me alone. You have to calling attention to your film once is perfectly appropriate and professional. But an onslaught is not. And you may think that emailing me every week to tell me you got into another festival, or this is what happened to your film, or is helping you, and it's quite the opposite. It's because it becomes overwhelming to me. So, feel free to, introduce yourself, to make that first email. But after that, I think the film, in the end, the film lives or dies on its own, really.
I would agree. I do. I like getting emails as well. They do go into a folder that I will check and will occasionally pass around. But mostly, the films. We're especially at Sundance, where we have 8,000 submissions. We're being assigned through our coordinator's office a lot of films at random, because we have we have the resources to do that. The films we're evaluating, it may not necessarily be yours or the one that you've emailed, and we may not end up giving that. It's all going to be on the strength of the individual film anyways. I can't ever think of a scenario in which any of myself or my colleagues' minds were changed because the email suddenly made us enjoy or appreciate the film more. I can definitely think of times where the email has made us appreciate the film less, but that's still not going to have any bearing on whether or not the film is going to get in. And same with like buddying up or being friends. I appreciate, like with at LAFF, we have a reassigned policy. If you feel like you're too close to the filmmaker, you need to give that to another person to evaluate that film. The nice thing that I appreciate about having friends is you know that who make films is, you know if they're a good friend, they will be okay with their rejection letter and not kind of bother you about that. It's heartbreaking as well because this also happens with filmmakers who you've played before and you've really enjoyed and spent a lot of time with, and their next film may not have a place in the festival. And so it's not just the first time filmmakers. This is sort of something that happens with alums at kind of any level.
There's two tips that I feel I should say. One is we're really organized. We do, at Sundance, we do get 8,000 short film submissions, but we also get 4,000 feature film submissions. So there's 12,000 submissions in our office floating around, and there's a lot of programmers, and the features have screeners, so there's a lot of processes, but everything's organized, and things do not get lost. I mean, we try really hard, and both Lane and I have worked at the administration level, and can guarantee you that we really work hard to make sure things don't get lost. And email's always helpful, but constant emails and emailing all the programmers, and when someone figures out like our name, how our names work on emails and emailing everybody, it's actually counterproductive. But the other tip is that all programmers kind of know each other. We're really good friends with the programmers at South By, and we know a lot of people in New York and all over the world internationally as well. So we kind of tell each other these stories. So if something goes down with the film festival, there's a chance that someone might hear. So we're just giving a little warning to be careful. And it's always nice to say hi to us and like introduce yourself, especially at cocktails and around. If you hear that someone's a programmer, it's great, introduce yourself. But yeah, always have a little bit of be aware that, you know, constantly bombarding someone with emails, even in your personal life, is intense.
Yeah, to add to that, that reminds me. When people say, I want to make sure the film is viewed by the right person, or it doesn't get lost in the pile, it's like, yeah, there's this implication that there are piles where films get lost. And we spend a lot of time working on that. There's a number of people who work very tireless hours to like properly evaluate the film. If you pay the submission fee, the least we can do is watch
the whole thing.
So if your film is broken or has a problem, you will be contacted. If you're worried about that, you can definitely send an email to their programming department. But like people are going to contact you, so you don't have to worry about trying to get in everybody's faces. Again, because we're organized as well, I don't like take DVD, like don't hand a DVD to me, because we have, in order to keep that system working, you have to submit properly, otherwise everything breaks down.
If I could just add to that, we're also just all human, so just the idea of this, here's my film, and just so many films you guys are going through, we're all going through all the time, and to get bombarded and all this stuff, it doesn't mean we're not getting to your film just because you sent that email and I didn't watch it in 24 hours. Right. I mean, it's going to take a couple of weeks, or this is what, we all have our own systems of how, especially within reviewing and how films get passed from one to the other, but we're also human, just watching a lot of films, and we will get to your film, and we will get back to you. I mean, it's very much the same at Fandor in the sense that we will, take a look at your film, and there are filmmakers we have worked with, license their feature, and then, we'll talk, and, oh, I have these shorts, they'll send us those, and nope, they're not going to work for us. And again, working with the type of filmmakers and distributors that understand that. That's what we're really, hoping to build out. It's really hard out there. And the rejection side of it, which I'm sure we might even start getting into it, those are also horror stories, I'm sure. Because you can't have everything, you guys can't program everything. We can't have everything up on our site. And so receiving a rejection, email or letter, I know isn't pleasant, but responding like with death threats, or I can't believe that you don't know anything about cinema, and these very bombastic and it gets very personal, at least for me, and you guys can jump in here, but you have to kind of step back and go, so they're discrediting everything about me as a human being, apparently I'm terrible, it should go to somebody else, I know nothing about movies, and I should be fired right now. All in one evening.
Yeah, I think you also have to remember that it's 3,000 down to 60, and your film might have been really close. Right. Sometimes the programmer will send you a person. rejection, then, you know, they might have been really excited about your film and have been looking forward to your next one, but...
But now you're an ass. We have the wall of shame. Trying to count the best responses to email rejections go on the wall. Because, seriously, it's not, you can't take it personally. Let's say I only have 60 spots and you were 61. Well, bummer for you, but that means that I'm gonna call my buddies at Toronto and say, hey, I loved this movie and I couldn't squeeze it in. Give it a look, will you? But if you're the ass, I'm skipping over you and going to the next guy, because that means that you are in trouble and that means that you are not a professional. And if you are going to, if you want to be a one-hit wonder, that's fine. But if what you want to do is be a filmmaker for your life, then there's another film down the road, and you're going to want me to watch that one. So telling me off is not going to get me on your good side, because you have no idea why you didn't get in. And you could have been this close, and we do talk to each other. And we do recommend films for each other. When I need something, if I'm looking for something for a special project, because we each do a number of different things. So if I'm doing a special project, and let's say I need sci-fi films, then I could call some of these other programmers and say, hey guys, what sci-fi stuff have you seen lately that might be good for me? And you want to be very careful. You know, my rule is hit save, not send. That's the email.
You might have programmers recommending films to each other, but Landon, you might even sort of recommend one to yourself.
Yeah, I recommend films to myself all the time.
So, rule of thumb, develop strong relationships with programmers and don't send them mean emails.
Another thing that I say actually is like, we start, for example, Sundance is opening submissions in July. We don't make decisions until the end of the year. We've lived with watching films for, you know, there's probably something I really loved in July and I've lived with it for 6 months. There's 6 months that I've developed this relationship with this film and 6 months that I've like thought about ways that it would play and almost even fantasized with like the filmmaker getting in and like, but maybe at the end it just doesn't make it. But so we do have relationships with these films. And it is sometimes heartbreaking that it doesn't happen. So we do care a lot, and I think that's the important part. We care a lot and we're human. And sometimes just because of the space, it's just kind of get it.
Absolutely. So from the films you love to what really is a turn off for you in a short film? What are the sort of common mistakes you see? What are your sort of instant red flags? And also, how do you feel about runtime? I think it's generally considered to be challenging to program longer shorts. What's your take on that? Do you try to include a few longer shorts in your program? Do you have recommendations for filmmakers of things they can do to make their films more programmable?
Chelsea.
Well, we have, like Landon mentioned, we have five programs, so four narrative shorts. So it's, you know, the longer the short, the harder it is for us to put into a program just because it takes the room of three or four or even five other short films. So what we always say is, you know, that your short film should be the length it should be. I can't tell you to cut your film if you feel that that's exactly the way it should be. But tendencies are that you can take off a couple minutes. If your film's 20 minutes, 30 minutes, we always suggest that you show it to 10 strangers and see, you know, what people think, how they feel about it. If maybe a scene is not essential, couple pauses or looking up into nothingness and not essential, then maybe, you know, those couple minutes could come off. But it really should be up to you and not try to please or try to figure out what we like or what we're, like what Jose really is into to get into the festival.
I'd say be ruthless with your edit and listen to listen to the feedback. You don't have to take every single note that every person says, but if 10 different people are saying a certain aspect or a few scenes or a moment or the runtime isn't working, then look into that, you know, and play around and take the time, which may mean you miss some festival deadlines while you're trying to perfect your film. In the long run, that's probably going to be better because you'll end up with a stronger movie. yes, we, you know, longer films are harder to program, but we actually have been, we have a tendency to have a few long films in almost every program at Sundance the last few years, because those particular films worked at that length and they were very strong films. There are incredible 30-minute films, there are terrible 2-minute films. You'd never know, you gotta find the right length. I mean, I would try to make it as short as it can possibly be, but if you take a bunch of stuff out and it's not working, then put some of that stuff back in. Yeah, I think the runtime should, I guess, be something that's in the back of your head, but like your goal shouldn't be to make a 12-minute film, it should be to make the film that you're dying to make.
Any pet peeves?
It's bothering me to see so much money in films that have very low kind of story lately, because, you know, when something looks cheap and didn't cost too much to make, if it's not that great, that's fine, but when I see somebody wasting like $50,000 and upwards on something with that looks great but has, you know, nothing going on to it, that really starts to make me think about all the things that money could have been used for. That's really upsetting.
Anyone else? Red flags?
You know what I've seen a lot of lately is really long end credit sequences due to your crowdfunding campaigns. Mm. Because you've been promising people that they're going to be in the credits. I just, this year, saw a film that was 8 minutes long and had 6-minute end credits. They thanked every person in their Kickstarter campaign slowly. So think about the promises that you're making to your crowdfunding people and how best to expedite those promises. Can you just put everybody's name on one big text card and hold for a second and then move on? But I find there's a lot of fat now in the end credits because the sequences are going so long. I agree with everybody on the running time thing. It's your film is as long as strong as your script is, but you have to understand the repercussions. The longer you get, the more challenging the film is to program. I've programmed long shorts and short shorts, and it's the best shorts that I see. I think for documentary shorts in general, we tend to give a little more leeway in terms of longer running times because they take sometimes a lot of time to develop. Narratives, you gotta move it along. As I would say, whatever your version is, should be as efficiently edited as possible so that the story is not lacking, but moves at an appropriate pace.
Speaking of long closing credit sequences, I'm not a huge fan of long opening credit sequences for shorts generally either.
They put it in like it's a feature. Yeah, unless that is somehow a comment on the story you're being told or feels like it's a part of your narrative, why do that?
I'm glad I noticed that. I'm not being able to comment this fully because in time constraints and in programming and what you guys are doing for a program, it's different. So, but it really comes down to quality and the story. That is, between all of this, you need to tell the story in the time it takes, and that could be, again, 10 seconds, and it could be much longer than that. So, again, we have just films of all lengths. So I don't know if it necessarily, applies this way, but it really does come down to, we will see those films where you're saying it's a narrative film that goes on for far too long. We just, no, it's not gonna, if it's not working, it won't work there.
Amanda, what are your content restrictions in terms of some films like sex, violence, that sort of thing?
Sex and violence, Fandor loves it. Bring it on. we actually, if we, in our QCing process and whatnot, we will put up like a mature audience banner if there's a lot of nudity and sex, but believe me, we have a lot of it on Fandor. And so we don't, again, also don't have that restriction that you guys might have when it comes to, thinking about your audience.
So the next question is kind of a two-parter. A lot of filmmakers ask me about their strategic kind of submission strategy. So a lot of filmmakers will submit to maybe what they consider to be the top five, the big five, and then they don't know what to do next. Should they also blanket submit to lots of other sort of second and third tier festivals, or should they wait to hear back from the top tier festivals first? Do you have any advice with regards to that? And then I think that feeds also into the question of premier status. Does premier status matter for shorts, and what do your respective festivals, what are your guidelines in terms of premieres for short films?
Sundance doesn't have a premiere requirement for short films, nor does LA Film Festival or AFI Fest. We have a kind of window of eligibility, so at AFI we're pretty strict. Your film has to have been completed after submissions closed the year before. So you really only have less than a year window, I would say. And then it's about that much for LA Film Festival. We'll take about a year and some change, you'll still be eligible, or if you submitted a work in progress last year and now you have a completed film or a significantly re-edited version, you'll be allowed to resubmit to Sundance. But we've played plenty of films that have been broadcast on European television or have hits on YouTube. That's not going to knock them out for us. That's not what we're looking for. We also know our audience at Sundance, the short film houses are going to be full no matter what we show. So we're set there with our audience. We can kind of show what we feel are the boldest, most risk-taking, interesting films, or what makes our programs feel like they're most diverse and kind of, full of content. So premiere status isn't going to be a factor. We think short filmmakers need all the help they can get, and a lot of opportunities that they've had in the past, or you've had in the past, have kind of dwindled. So I think it was before I started working there that Sundance kind of stripped the premiere requirement away from shorts, and it's opened up a lot of options that we can do with the program since.
I mean, submitting to film festivals gets really expensive. There's a lot of film festivals, and I'm sure with Without a Box, there's just so many options. So this is when a little bit of extra work comes in, where you have to research and see where your film maybe would have a best home, in determining where you're going to submit. See what other films have played there. Is it similar to yours? Is the film festival's audience similar to yours? Which film festivals give prizes, like money prizes? Which film festivals maybe fly you out? Maybe that's something that you're interested in. There's some short film festivals international film festivals that will give you money to come out. And that's also important, because then you can network, you can meet some other film festivals, you can create a community there. So all these things factor into making your own plan. But yeah, obviously, it also depends if your film is still has a premiere. There's certain film festivals that have a premiere requirement. And then also, so you want to see which ones have that premiere requirement and make your choice of where you want to submit, or submit to all of them and hope that's one of the first ones you play. Like Lennon said, we don't have a premiere requirement at Sundance. We prefer it, like everyone, but it's not something that that we focus on. We've played films that, like you said, our big example was Chimay Baba's Chema's film?
Mysterio.
Played Berlin and then played all over the world and then played it again at Sundance. So it was a good year run that played Berlin and AFI, all a bunch of international film festivals, and then we still felt like it fit at Sundance the next year and it still fit in our year.
We also played Doc Ellis and the LSD No No, which was a big YouTube hit that year. Marcel Chanel with Shoes On, the first one of that series. And Drunk History, one of the Drunk History shorts before it was a series, which actually won our grand jury prize that year in 2010.
But it's obviously something that we not only fit, but need, we thought would appreciate another little bit international push.
So hold that thought regarding films from YouTube and Drunk History, etc., because that's what we're going to talk about next. But I just wanted to quickly check in with you, Sharon.
Yeah.
Rebecca does tend to
the opposite. Premier status is very important to me. We require a minimum of a New York regional premiere. That means the whole area, the boroughs, Connecticut, New Jersey. But world premieres get priority. Why? Because we get a lot of eyeballs, and I want to launch a film. So if I want to launch a film, then I'm looking for the newest work. It also has to do with me physically coming at the end of the calendar year. So Sundance has already passed. South By has already passed, Aspen has already passed, and then there's May. And so I need to compete. In order for me to compete, I need to look for a newer crop of films. So world premieres, 40 out of 60 of the films I showed this year were world premieres. And so that is important for my festival. But that's the I think the point we're all making is that you have to do your research and understand what requirements each festival has, so that when you're entering post, that you can start that strategy, because your festival calendar begins when your film is ready. And then who's next? What is the next festival that's still open for submission that you want to apply to? And do you meet their criteria? And that everybody has their own rules. So it's up to you to be kind of detective with that.
Yeah, I don't think you can overstate the importance of research and people who are really good at advising you if you don't know about filmmakers. Programmers. So once again.
Yeah, and you also
have a plan. Yeah. Oh, just have a plan, because some people bank like, oh, I'm gonna get into Cannes and that's it. And then when you get the no, what happens now? And then all the submissions passed already. Mm-hmm. So have your plan B, C, D.
Yeah, and don't waste your time. I mean, sometimes I get submissions and I think, why did they send that to me? Like some grisly grindhouse horror film, that might not be the right fit for me. So don't just send it out there. Send it out there with forethought. I remember 1 year I got pornographic claymation. It was fantastic.
I think I programmed that film.
Probably. It was stuff you never want to see in clay. In clay? It was totally 100% X-rated. I couldn't show it. But boy, I knew some festivals that could, and trust me, I picked up the phone and said, do I have something for you? But the filmmaker, wasted their money. It all comes down to money and
not necessarily.
Time. Yeah.
Not if you call other festivals.
Yeah, but you should have been directly submitting to the festivals that were appropriate to the film to begin with. What if I was too busy to make those phone calls?
That's true.
And bear in mind, there are also still a lot of festivals that don't charge submission fees, a lot of the European ones, so that's...
Yeah. There's a good
research
site
to do too.
Called shortfilmdepot.com that'll show you what international festivals don't have submission fees. There's a whole list. I mean, festivals, tons of festivals that look very interesting or that you may not have heard of, or that some of them may be in small towns and may not be worth kind of the print traffic fee of sending them over. But, that's all the stuff you have to figure out. But kind of to speak to Sharon's point, there's... if you have a niche film, there are so many niche festivals that are very reputable that a lot of folks are still going to, so you can get your film in front of some of the same eyeballs who will be at different festivals in kind of a more intimate, appropriate showcase. There's tons of genre festivals. There's tons of LGBTQ festivals. There's tons of doc festivals. You can find a way to get your film in front of those people, and you have more options. Festival that's only playing docs means you're not competing for narrative slots. If it's only a genre festival, you don't have to compete with everything else. You just kind of have to be the best in your, or a student festival if you're a student. Anything you can do to increase the number of slots you have and to decrease the number of submissions that you're going up against, I think that's smart. There's always going to be somebody at those festivals who you will have wanted to see your film.
Save your money.
As programmers who go to lots of different festivals, get invited to juries, etc., do any of you have any particular favorites that the audience might not know of, that you like niche festivals or festivals that you would recommend them looking into?
Yeah, there's plenty of great, it all depends on what you want to get out of it. Like in terms of kind of US regional festivals that are a great kind of community experience, I'm a big fan of the Maryland Film Festival, Sarasota, the Denver Film Festival is great.
Fantastic Fest.
Fantastic Fest is a wonderful genre festival. I went to Aspen Shorts Fest once. I had a really great time. That's they really take care of shorts filmmakers there, and they have this kind of really strong sense of community, and just really they do really sharp communities over there that I really enjoy. Like there's a lot of festivals that everybody's sort of doing their own, they have their own unique spin or do something to try to stand out, but anytime that involves creating a filmmaker community, I feel like that's a festival you want to go to. You'll hear about that very easily by just looking into, if you just keep up with where short films are going, going to panels like this or listening to Q&As or looking at their websites, like people will talk about the festivals. Word of mouth will spread on the festivals that they really enjoyed.
I think any other festival recommendations? I have one more question, and I think we're going to open it up to the audience.
I like going down to Mexico because it's actually, your flight to Mexico is sometimes cheaper to go than from the East Coast to the West Coast. So Guanajuato Film Festival shows your films in caves. It's so awesome to go there. Guadalajara, the Oaxaca Film Festival, and they have great accommodations, and you meet filmmakers from all over the world. So
Amanda, any faves?
I like the community aspect of it. So I was thinking that the Game Divide is like Ashland and Bend and these like smaller film festivals that really, I mean, not small, but they're well, you know, they have a good reputation. And the in part of doing your research is, again, with also attending these festivals, which you hope to go to with your film, it's what are you going to get out of it? It's having that experience of knowing, are there industry people there? Are there panels I can go see? Are there going to be, you know, filmmakers there? And kind of realizing like which festivals, again, especially in the shorts market, you know, if you're going, you get into a lot of festivals, it's kind of then also cherry picking as to which festivals I should attend. And that's important to look into as to what you can get out of it, especially when you're typically, unfortunately, probably having to spend your own money to travel there and, you know, your own accommodation. So really thinking what, you know, what you can benefit from those festivals. So those two came to mind, but I mean, so many.
Great festivals, Sharon.
You also want to think about festivals that are Academy qualifiers, because you never know. So among them, one of my favorites is, believe it or not, the Hot Springs Documentary Film Festival in Hot Springs, Arkansas. It's fantastic. I juried it last year. Hot Springs is a great place. It's in a national forest and national park. It's fun, you know? It's a part of the experience of being a filmmaker is like, you know, roaming the globe and having these experiences. And I personally love genre films, so Fantasia in Montreal is one of my favorites.
Great. Finally, and then we'll open it up to the audience. I'm sure you have some questions for our programmers, but the question that everybody's talking about at festivals right now, especially with regards to shorts, is of course, you can now self-distribute your short online as soon as it's finished. Should you put your film online? If so, when? Does it jeopardize the chance of festival success, a successful festival run, or even would Fandor be resistant to picking up a film that had been online? Maybe start.
Sure. This maybe bring up an interesting discussion between all of us because I think we all have different rules about this. So Fandor wants, we want your film to have festival play. We're not this, we offer non-exclusive licensing. So your film actually could also be on Vimeo and you can do iTunes transactional, you can be on Amazon and you can still also be on Fandor. But again, that's a part of it that comes into the research aspect and, you know, in your more digital distribution outlets. But they're two different audiences. You know, we're an audience that's on streaming devices and we're on your at-home television. And, you know, that's different than going to a theater. And we really, you know, we're out, Fandor, you know, goes to other film festivals and talks about that and, you know, meets other programmers and knows that community because the value of seeing what's going on within the industry. But interestingly enough, you know, we're probably the ones that don't necessarily really care about that. We'll get that question a lot, let me rephrase that. The filmmakers will finish their film, they'll email or, you know, send it to a screener and say, I just finished my film, I want it up on Fandor. And my first question is, you should actually go probably submit this to film festivals, and we kind of talk about that a little bit. You should have, you know, start building that audience and have it seen in a proper theater and have that in whole experience. But if they definitely just want to go to the digital distribution route, that's fine as well. You know, we ask them if that's what they want to do, knowing that once it does go up on Fandor, festivals then might actually say, no, we can't look at that film. But I will say that the whole industry right now is changing. So we're actually, in a lot of ways, working with programmers on doing essentially like day and dates where a film will play. We use Mill Valley for an example, Telluride, like a film will premiere there and we'll have it up online. And so we are working, we know each other, we know the programmers, we know what's going on in the industry, we know the filmmakers that are working that. They would be interested in having their film premiere online at the same time that their film is playing in a theater. And we can even do things like geo-blocking it if that's necessary so that we make sure that audience couldn't actually access it on Fandor. And then it's also, funny enough, we've had instances where the film has been put on Fandor and then programmers come to us to watch it and then play it at their film festival. and they ask us for the contact. So it's just, which, you know, is that's not saying that happens a lot, but that has happened before. So it's very, it's interesting because so many things about that is changing. You know, and those questions I'm sure you all have is, what is the appropriate time for it to go online? And will that, you know, is that really the end of my festival run? And, you know, those are really important questions to ask yourself right now, especially with the digital space, and there's so many places that your film can go online. And I'm sure, again, you guys will all have, you know, things to say on that, that probably when the film goes online, it might not be available. And we're really trying to build, you know, we don't really believe in that kind of exclusivity on Fandor. We want as much, you know, eyes on it in all, on all forms and on all screens.
But Amanda, is the Fandor deal exclusive, or can the filmmaker have their film on their own website and
they
video
can have the film on their own
website too?
It's, so it's non-exclusive. All of our licensing is non-exclusive.
I mean, it's, I guess it's what do you want to get out of your film ultimately? If do you want the prestige of festivals? Do you want more eyes on it? I mean, more people. If you launch smartly, if you like launch the right way in on, you know, going online, more people can see your film in 2 days than can see in like a 60 festival run. A lot of these festivals have small theaters or have kind of limited audiences, or maybe you play somewhere that you have kind of, you know, not a lot of people in those theaters. And if those were festivals that wouldn't let you put it online, or if there are people asking to see your short and can't find it, you know, what do you do then? Is just kind of having more people see it, is having the hits important to you, or perhaps being able to monetize that, or do you want to be able to premiere like something like Tribeca or Telluride or Cannes? It's gonna be different. You know, there are some films that maybe aren't right, maybe they're a little too long or a little too maudlin, so that they're never gonna do that well online, but people may really appreciate them. I know that I get a lot of calls from various kind of agents or other folks who wanna look at films, but don't know how to find them. So, I mean, in a certain case, maybe you wanna do a best of both worlds thing, just to have always have your film available and ready to whoever sees it, even if you don't make it publicly available online. I mean, do you think, I know the Academy has very strict rules about being online, but that's also a very, very limited and very specific type of short. So do you really wanna blow your chances of having a lot of people see your short when it's getting momentum to kind of play those odds and try to be one of the couple of shorts that may be shortlisted for an Academy? Like, you should do, you know, ask us, ask other people, figure out what your short is and how you can best capitalize on that, because there's no universal answer. Some of your shorts are gonna do way better if you put them online tomorrow, but some of you may wanna wait. But either way, at some point, you should get your short to a place where people can see it or find it if they want to. There's very few ways after your festival run for anybody to see your film.
Yeah, I like the idea, which I think was in a presentation from your coworker, Katie Metcalf, that was that when you release your new short for its festival run, you should make your last short available publicly online.
Oh yeah,
and
yeah,
use that
for
as a marketing
sure.
tool, which I think is a really great idea. And Sherry, what's the typical?
Yes, online is ineligible. For the reasons I discussed before, if I'm looking for new work and I'm looking for unexposed work, then it's world premiere, no online. But then, you know, again, it's your choice. It's your choice of, you know, how you want to handle your festival run. And I totally agree, some films should just go online. Like, go online, because that's where your audience lives. So.
So it goes back to research and seeing what you want to do. And also, I mean, if you really want to premiere Tribeca, but you put it online, don't send it to Tribeca. I mean, that's another no, because, you know, obviously you didn't read the rules there. But for example, for Sundance, since we do know that, since everyone knows we don't have a premiere requirement, we do play things that are online. Sometimes all of us actually are constantly looking on YouTube, Vimeo, and Tumblr, and, you know, all over looking for different films that weren't sent to us, or, you know, somehow. So things, we're always looking and researching. So it's, things will be found, but it's really up to you to figure out what your plan is. I've had filmmaker friends that have had successful launches online, and they were okay with skipping over Sundance and, you know, Berlin. But
Sundance doesn't disqualify the film.
No, they don't. But they just wanted to, for it to live there, not even apply. So, you know, that's their choice, and they were happy with it. maybe, you know, but one thing that Glenn did say that was really important is that a lot of people come to us looking for filmmakers that, you know, they're asking us, can you recommend a director that can shoot this, you know, TV show or whatever, and we can't show them the film because you've locked it and put it in a secret place and no one can see it, that it's really hard for everyone to, you know, to help you out or discover you or keep going with, you know, your
sure.
So
we're not going to share your submission.
We're not going to share your submission.
Because that's very internal and private.
Because most of the time you sent us like a work in progress. So I also don't want to send someone, you know, work in progress, because then that, you know, that just counteracts.
Sure, so we have everything from someone that's actively looking for content online to try to get disqualifying content that's online. So it just shows you how much that landscape is changing. And
it leaves you with choices. You have and options. And, you know, one thing to the point of premiere requirements is that, yeah, it does level the playing field a little bit. It means that if you are applying to like Tribeca or I know there's a few other festivals that want world premieres, you don't have to worry about competing you know, with the new Don Hertzfeld short that everybody wants to program and whatnot. So there is more space for you as a new fresh filmmaker.
I was gonna say it's only gonna continue to change. Because years ago, when the MoMaker film went on YouTube, I know probably a lot of programmers would have said no. And then that question is now depending on your audience and, you know, the type of festival that you have. And yes, you know, if you have the world premiere status and that's what you're looking for. And there's a lot of festivals, I mean, as you can imagine, there's hundreds of festivals in between the festival, you know, panelists up here that maybe not as high profile that are really struggling for that maybe content and not able to get the world premiere. So it will only continue to change. And that, I think, is a good thing for the filmmaker, but it's also very scary because it's completely unknown and it's kind of figuring out, you know, just being aware of all of those changes and what's going on in the industry.
And places that are now showing shorts, I mean, Condé Nast just started picking up shorts, and so now they want exclusivity. So if you were to put your short online, you kind of lost the contract there. Or, you know, your OpDocs, there's just different options. So just know that there's new platforms and new things going on. Just keep researching and being aware of what's going on and where shorts are being shown.
I would like to turn it over to the audience, despite multiple hands. Start over here.
I just wondered if there's any kind of a professional that helps orchestrate this distribution process or an app.
I was wondering if there's a professional that helps orchestrate this distribution process or an app where it helps match up these criteria. I know in college submissions, for instance, for children, you can have different categories you input in apps and they tell you which colleges would be the most appropriate to start with. Do you know anything like that?
Make it up.
Like submission devices? Like I know Without a Box will .com and Film Freeway.
I mean someone who helps you orchestrate the series of people you apply to in what order and what dates.
Oh.
To orchestrate this whole process, because why should a filmmaker focus or a producer focus, they'd have to become an expert to do this right. And if there's a person existing or role existing,
I think some filmmakers do hire people specifically to do
strategists, yeah.
What do they call them?
Film festival strategists. But, you know, you got a lot of money. They cost a lot of money. So, you know, I'd spend the money doing research if I
were. Yeah, because I feel like...
Because the rules keep changing.
And then also, in your future, you already know. I mean, you'll be submitting other shorts.
Yeah, you'll benefit. You'll benefit by learning that process rather than rely on somebody else who can make promises that then... I mean, if your film got into a festival, who's to say that's because of anything an outside person you hired did? Maybe your film was just good enough to get into that festival or a programmer responded to that. So it's like, I feel like you can hire someone who can exist to then take credit when things go good and then have a number of reasons why it wasn't their fault when you do get rejected. I don't know, I feel like educating yourself on how to kind of release your film on a platform for it will only be good for you.
Getting to know as many people as you can in the industry and people who work for festivals who can give you sound advice.
Make your own contacts.
This is a very specific question, but on Without a Box, there's like the option to always include a cover letter, and I just find myself being like, is anyone going to care what I put in this cover letter? Do you have a feeling about that? Do you like anyone? Do you not care about it?
I actively avoid reading your cover letter. It's personal. I don't know about my colleagues, but I actively avoid reading your cover letter. I want to know as little as possible when I watch the film.
If I like your film, your cover letter can give me ammunition against him. Like in debates. But yes.
No, I mean, I'll look up if I like the film, or if it has, even if I don't like the film, if there's some interest or something that I'm curious about, I will certainly look up information afterwards because I want to know. But it's easier to just go into the film blind, and that's with any film. I just don't want to play favorites in any scenario or have extra knowledge going in.
But if you do have like some, you know, correspondence to that actual festival or whatever, it's fine to dump it into the cover letter and then you'll kind of
Without a box, yes.
Right, right.
It's not hurting.
Yeah,
it's
not hurting.
I would say it makes more sense to email the programmer directly though.
But like, yeah, if you're an alum of a festival and you want to include that with a cover letter, and maybe you were an alum a while ago and it's a new programming staff, that's good for that person to know or look at. I just wouldn't rely on anybody reading that.
Don't rely on it. And also, I think you said sending it to the programmer. I think I would read the cover letter without a box home rather than the one that I get sent. Yeah, so it's just everyone's different, but I think it doesn't hurt you, but it don't rely on it.
Thank you for this panel. I'm Lauren Joseph. My name is Celine. About niche, I created last month in Los Angeles a screening of short film, 3D short film, all directed by women. Has any of your festival did a 3D screening in the past, 3D selection, and also is it possible to send you 3D short films?
I mean, I can start there. We're not yet at 3D. It was 3D, correct? Yeah. We're not yet at that capability, I guess, and because that also involves the, you know, the television and, you know, what you're actually screening it on. So, and that's kind of unfortunate because there have been films that we were very interested in, actually, and that was a part of it where we would be talking to the filmmaker, like, do you actually have a 2D version of the film? So unfortunately, we are not yet there. Not to say that might not happen.
We take 3D submissions at Sundance, but the if it's accepted, it'll screen at the festival in 3D. But the way, just based on, what kind of lack of technology that we have access to easily for the submissions process, you either have to send the 2D version and explain very clearly, like in a title card before the film starts, that it's meant to show in 3D, or you have to provide like the 3D glasses, and because we don't have 3D TVs necessarily at our disposal, it has to be those red, the red, you know, the really kind of, what are they called? Anaglyph?
Glasses. A bunch of those hanging around.
And it's not ideal. It's kind of, it's not great. You can't replicate the experience, but we will and have shown 3D at a number of festivals I've worked at and attended.
To play the festival?
None of the festivals I work for will pay screening fees for a short film.
What about the futures?
It depends on the festival. AFI's Fest is a free festival. We don't charge tickets, and therefore we don't pay screening fees. Generally, you're only really paying a screening fee for like kind of a big film with an international sales agent or distributor that, you know, you're dying to have. I mean, if you're submitting to a festival, you're paying for the chance to play. It doesn't make any sense to charge a screening fee.
Where's the mic? Great.
I was just wondering what it was like since you guys all program for different festivals to program for festivals where maybe they're just getting going or they're so far into it versus programming for festivals for very respectively, like Scorsese and De Niro's festival isn't going anywhere, or Redford. So how does that play into how you select films? Because I've seen people that went to Sundance and then like they dislike it more than something that's in a theater, and I know that's all opinion.
I don't think that's true, no. I think that, you know, the people are not, if we're selling tickets for $18 a pop, we have to be pretty confident that the film is going to appeal to the audience. You know, I can't just put up shadow puppets and expect people to show. It's not an automatic yet. That's why programming is so hard, because you're always trying to select the best films for your audience every year so that they show up and buy tickets and we can have another festival next year.
The keys for your audience, you know,
no, I mean, I just know Mark Scorsese is not going anywhere. I'm not doing it derogatory, it's just a general question.
I mean, it's also our reputation. We want
to stop supporting your company. Oh, I'm not saying.
Next question, where is the mic?
Question.
Anyone else?
I recently seen how.
Hold on one second, we're going to bring the mic over to you.
Sorry,
hold on, 35 seconds.
So I just seen the movie, it's called Dope, that is a distribution area through Sundance. Going back on how you guys said Sundance could really help the filmmakers get out there. Anything you can say about that movie?
About that Dope? I mean, that was bought at Sundance, so it's not, Sundance isn't or most festivals, they aren't, and Sundance especially is not a distributor, it's a showcase. It's an exhibition platform. So you know, the studio that released, and I'm blanking on who actually put Dope out.
Is it Baby Eyes?
Pardon?
Open Road. Oh, Open Road put out Dope? So yeah, they saw it at Sundance, and they're, you know, imagine it was maybe a little bit of a bidding war, and then they bought it at the festival. That's something that Sundance has kind of garnered a reputation of over the years, and it's certainly something that makes the Sundance brand attractive to feature filmmakers who want to submit. I will say this year for shorts, there were more kind of potential distribution options than there have been in the last 5 years over there, with, as Dilsia mentioned, Condé Nast getting into the game. New York OpDocs is still kind of around, and there's a new one. Oh, a CNN, didn't they buy?
Yes, CNN
bought a few shorts at the festival. So this was the first year we actually had kind of like press announcements of shorts being bought at Sundance that we selected in a few years. So it was really it was really exciting to see shorts start to kind of have that again. Since I've been programming, those kind of like options of playing on HBO and the Sundance Channel and IFC channel sort of went away after a while.
I wanted to clarify maybe this, because Sundance Film Festival is part of the Sundance Institute, and then there's Sundance branding that has nothing to do with the Institute, so there's Sundance Channel. We don't have anything to do with the channel. And then there's Sundance theaters. We don't have anything to do with the theaters. So we don't know who works there. We don't work with them. It's just a different brand with the same name. And then another thing is that we're doing at Sundance Film Festival is we're now, we've launched a tour of the shorts. So our shorts that get played, we play 60 shorts and then we give out awards. Some of the award winners get to go, or we select some of the award winners and they go travel around the US. We select theaters that usually don't get independent cinema come to them, so there's a little bit of money involved for the filmmakers. So we've started a little bit of distribution in that sense, helping the filmmakers get their films out to the rest of the US. We've done a little bit of international work with that too, but that's branded under the Sundance Film Festival brand.
Other questions?
Yeah. Is there a better time to submit, either early in the process or later? Does that make any difference? As far as submission dates?
It rarely matters. There's been years where, there's one year a couple years ago where the second film submitted, like number 0002, got into the festival. There are years where the very last thing that was viewed gets into the festival. It's not, the difference is how much you're paying. And, you know, really one of the reasons early deadlines were started was so that we don't get overwhelmed with thousands of submissions that come in on the same day, so that we can stagger the process and get our watching done in a timely fashion. At Sundance, we're still turning in the same list to each other at the same time every year with the films we want to put forward, no matter what, and it's gonna be filled with films that came in at all the different deadlines.
anyone else want to add to that?
Yeah, I think the reason for the early submission was to lessen the avalanche. And so if you're submitting early, like I would say roughly in our case, 25% of the submissions come in during early submission, 75% by the regular submission. So the benefit is if you're in that first 25%, chances are you're getting me to watch it, since my team's not coming on until the regular day.
That's interesting. Mm-hmm.
So.
And don't use the late deadline unless you have to. So just try to submit it, you know.
I will say this, yeah, don't game the system. If you choose to submit to the early deadline, and it's a work in progress, we really don't like when sometime near the late deadline you come to us and say, oh, I have the new version of the film. Like, you made the choice to submit to the early deadline. What you should be doing if you are still tinkering with your film is submitting the best version possible. So that's one where I would wait till the late deadline. Especially with the volume of submissions, the number of people watching them, how we're using our time, we can't guarantee we'll ever watch another cut of your film. Only the first version submitted, we can promise, will be seen. So you want to put your best foot forward. So that's where I'd use the late deadline, is if you're still working on your film.
I have a question about feature films. Does it help if you have, like, a Film Independent, Tribeca, or Sundance Lab a stamp on it? Of course, we're getting it after you complete it, if you went through a lab.
Meaning if you go through the lab and then you submit it to the festival?
Then the film is confirmed.
It's always we're gonna pay attention to it because you know, we've brought you up, so to speak, but it's not an automatic go.
What if it's a different lab for like Berlin Talent and we come to you for working there?
I wouldn't know that though, because we're screening the films blind. We're not screening them with all the backstory to them.
Sometimes they have the stamp. It's up to your work.
I mean, ideally it would help because the lab will have made your film stronger, since that's the idea. But no, it's not a guarantee that it'll get in. And even if you have a great film in any, whether it's a feature or a short, it's all dependent on the year, how many slots, other films like yours. I mean, it's kind of a bummer if your film is exactly like some other film that the programmers may respond to just a little bit more, you know, or how people want to organize their program.
But we are on top of those lists. We know, we like to know who's getting into talent campuses, who got funded by Tribeca. We want to know those. So most likely we already anticipate that, or we already know who you are when you're coming to us. Oh. Yeah.
I have a question about feedback. I know that you guys obviously have been Tribeca and Sundance receive huge amounts of films, so maybe getting feedback on why and what's successful. Probably not appropriate, but like local smaller film festivals, if you aren't successful and maybe you get to a couple of rounds and find that you're not successful, is it appropriate to ask why, or do you think that it's not really the program's role to do that?
I used to program Newport Beach Film Festival. It's also kind of a regional festival if I just jump in, and I mean, it's large, it's been around for a while, but I would say no, at least my personal experience, in just a timing aspect of it, and kind of, it's hard. I mean, there's definitely been times I've given feedback, but it wasn't, I wouldn't, now but thinking back on it, I wish I really didn't, because it's not for me to say. I think by the way, is that feedback, at least in my experience, is like, what did I do wrong, and how can I change it to then edit it to get it right, and then almost resubmit, kind of. And that isn't really my place to say, you know, especially for somebody, I didn't, you know, make this film, you know, where I'm coming from. So it's really difficult, you know, and in the process of when you probably get that rejection letter is when we're moving forward in programming. And we're actually like, you know, we're now putting the program together and we're doing all this, so the festival's actually happening. And then once the festival's over, you know, so you guys are kind of, we get like a break. I mean, Landon, it sounds like, it's just programming every day.
Very tired.
And then you're kind of moving on to your next event and to kind of, go back and talk to you about it. Granted, like, as you run into these filmmakers, you go to the same film festivals, and there's definitely times you talk about the film with them, but at least in my experience.
I one of the reasons that we have a no feedback policy is kind of what you hit on. It's the idea that we can't promise if you made any of the changes that you would even get in at all, and we don't want to have that kind of as something, like as a policy. Nothing we say can necessarily help you get your film into the festival. And we're not who you should be looking, like, we're not that close group of collaborators and friends and, you know, or even strangers that you want to be kind of ruthlessly looking at for feedback. We're here to judge films and take them as they are. Like, if we accept a film, even if it has flaws, we're not going to make that filmmaker change those flaws. We're taking the film warts and all. So we're not here to kind of make you tinker with or change or look at your work. We're here to provide a showcase for it. Also, again, there's so many submissions. A lot of people see them, you know, at different times. It takes a lot to sort of, you know, re-look at that. There have been cases where we'll look at if you've signed up for certain shorts labs that we do, maybe that comes with feedback, but it rarely works well too. It becomes a very awkward conversation. We find that oftentimes people aren't necessarily looking for feedback so much as they want you to like the film, or they want to tell you why what you think is wrong. Like, it goes south so often that it becomes a very uncomfortable experience. I think a lot of programmers start off, with my colleagues and myself, kind of thinking, oh, we'll help filmmakers, we'll give them all feedback, and then after a certain point, you understand why you can't do that anymore. Also, we need to keep sort of a space where our evaluators, you know, at the festivals, either where it's programmers or screeners or screening committee that's looking at films, that needs to be private so that everybody can feel that they have a safe space to be honest about their opinions about the work.
And it's equal for all the filmmakers. It's really not fair if I give someone feedback and then there's like 7,000 other people that wish they could get feedback. So, I don't know.
Did we have a final question? No, we have to finish. So please join me in thanking this wonderful